This is Rebecca from chemistryismyjam.com. In this video, we're going to be looking at periodic trends. These are the trends on the periodic table that help us understand the behavior of elements. We're going to look at ionization energy, electronegativity, atomic radius, and then the size of ions. These trends, along with much of what we see in chemistry, can be explained by forces between charged particles. You have particles with the same charge that are trying to get away from each other, and particles with opposite charges that are trying to get close together. These forces of attraction and forces of repulsion can be increased two different ways. First of all, you can increase the number of charged particles. For us, that's going to mean increasing the number of protons and electrons within the atom. The other way you can increase these forces is to decrease the distance between the particles. The closer they are together, the more they're going to feel each other. These two concepts are huge in understanding the trends that we will be looking at today. The first trend for us to talk about is something called ionization energy. This is the amount of energy required to remove an electron from an atom. When you remove an electron from an atom, you are creating an atom with a charge. You're creating an ion. So measuring that measures the amount of energy required to ionize the atom. Typically, when you just see the term ionization energy, that's talking about removing the first electron from an atom, and that electron would be coming from an outside energy level. So in the case of aluminum, the ionization energy would refer to how much energy is required to remove that electron from the atom. If you were to then go further and remove a second electron from the atom, we would call it the second ionization energy. And then you could have the third and the fourth ionization energy. But when you just see ionization energy, you're typically talking about removing one electron from the atom. On the periodic table, ionization energy typically increases from left to right and increases from bottom to top. So the overall trend could be represented with an arrow going from the bottom left to the top right of the periodic table. Helium has the highest ionization energy on the chart, which makes sense because helium is a very small atom. Its electrons are very close to the nucleus. They are very attracted to that positive charge inside the nucleus, which is going to make them difficult to remove. We saw in our last video that the atoms on the left side of the periodic table will normally give away electrons when they become ions. That makes sense because they have low ionization energies. It does not take much energy to remove those electrons. So ionization energy increases from left to right and increases from bottom to top. Let's take a look at what causes this trend. As you go from left to right across the periodic table, each element adds a proton to its nucleus. It's adding a positively charged particle to its nucleus. By having more protons in their nucleus, these elements on the right-hand side of the periodic table are able to hold on tighter to their electrons. It takes more energy, more ionization energy, to remove those electrons. Those protons in the nucleus, we call that the nuclear charge. So whenever you hear nuclear charge, that's just a way of referring to the number of protons within the nucleus. Ionization energy decreases from top to bottom on the periodic table because each time you go down a row on the periodic table, you are adding an energy level. So you add this energy level and that causes the electrons to be farther away from that positive charge in the center. That makes them easier to remove. So the electrons that are farther away from the nucleus have a lower ionization energy. That explains why every time you go down a row on the periodic table, you are lowering the ionization energy. While we are looking at the effect of energy levels on these electrons, let's look at a concept called shielding. An electron in the outside energy level is feeling two major forces. It's feeling attracted to the protons inside the nucleus of the atom. However, it's feeling repelled by the electrons that are between it and the nucleus. This makes an electron on the outside energy level fairly easy to remove. It's farther away from the nucleus, and it's being repelled by the inner electrons. The term that is often used to describe this concept is shielding. These electrons in the outside energy level are shielded from the nucleus by these inner electrons, and it makes these electrons easier to remove. In contrast, an electron that is on a lower energy level, like this one, would be extremely difficult to remove. It is very close to the nucleus, and the electrons that are farther out are actually pushing it towards the nucleus. So one that's on an inner energy level would be extremely difficult to remove. The second trend on the periodic table that we need to discuss is called electronegativity. Electronegativity is the ability of an atom in a molecule to attract shared electrons to itself. So we're talking about two atoms that are bonded together. One of them has the ability to hog the electrons. It pulls the electrons closer to itself. The one that is hogging the electrons is said to have a higher electronegativity. When we look at the trend for electronegativity, you're going to notice that it does not include the noble gases. And that's because electronegativity deals with bonded atoms and the noble gases do not bond. So we'll be ignoring the noble gases when we talk about this trend. The element with the highest electronegativity value on the chart is fluorine. Here you can see the trend for electronegativity on the periodic table. Electronegativity increases from left to right. It increases from bottom to top. This trend ignores the noble gases because the noble gases never bond with any other atoms. And the highest value of electronegativity on the periodic table is fluorine. The reasons behind this trend are very similar to the ones that we just looked at for ionization energy. As you go from left to right across the periodic table, you are adding protons to the nucleus, and those protons are able to pull electrons closer to themselves. As you go from top to bottom on the periodic table, energy levels are being added. The electrons are getting further away from the nucleus. That's increasing the distance between one atom's nucleus and another atom's electrons. That's going to decrease the amount of pull that they can have on those electrons. So electronegativity increases from left to right, and it increases from bottom to top. The third trend on the periodic table that we need to discuss is atomic radius. We're basically looking now at the size of the atom. One thing to point out is that the atom does not have an outer barrier, so this is something that's difficult to measure. The way scientists measure this is by taking two identical atoms that are bonded together. They can tell where the nuclei are for those two atoms. They measure that distance between the two nuclei, divide that distance in half, and it gives you the atomic radius. So two identical bonded atoms are used to determine the atomic radius. In general, the atomic radius increases as you go from right to left on the periodic table, and it increases as you go down the periodic table. If you're looking at the main body elements on the periodic table, francium should have the largest atomic radius. The reasons behind this trend are very similar to the reasons that we just saw. Atomic radius increases as you go down the periodic table because each time you're adding an energy level, and energy levels take up space. Atomic radius decreases as you go from left to right across the periodic table because you're increasing the nuclear charge. By having more protons in the nucleus, the protons are able to have more pull on the electrons. So they pull those electrons closer to themselves and shrink the atom as you go from left to right across the periodic table. Reactivity is another important trend on the periodic table. This is referring to how easy it is to get an element to react with another element. The most reactive metals are on the lower left portion of the periodic table. The electrons for francium are extremely easy to remove. It's a big atom with low ionization energy. Those electrons are easy to remove, making that a very reactive element. The trend is the opposite for the nonmetals. The most reactive nonmetals are in the upper right corner. Fluorine would be the most reactive nonmetal. This trend ignores the noble gases because they are not reactive at all. The final trend for us to discuss is ion size. This is comparing the size of an ion to the size of its neutral atom. What you will find is that cations are smaller than their parent atoms, and anions are larger than their parent atoms. Take sodium for example. When sodium becomes an ion, it actually gives away an electron. It loses an entire energy level. So sodium, when it becomes an ion, takes a positive charge and gets smaller. Cations are smaller than their parent atoms. The opposite of that would be something like bromine. Bromine is going to gain electrons when it becomes an ion. This is going to cause the bromine ion to actually get larger. Anions are larger than their parent atoms. On the periodic table, ion size increases as you go down a group. It decreases from left to right across the periodic table. So you may notice that this just followed the same trend as atomic radius. The only exception is that when you switch from positive to negative charges, you should notice a sharp increase in size when you switch from those positive metals on the left side of the periodic table to those negative nonmetals on the right side of the periodic table. I hope that this unit on the periodic table has shown you what a powerful tool that it can be. If you have found these videos helpful, please like, share, and subscribe to ChemistryIsMyJam.com.